All right, well, it's 2 o'clock, so I might as well get going. Hey everyone, my name is Michael Loxo. I'm gonna be doing a panel called In Defense of Moe, Why We Love Cute Stuff. I didn't know how many people were gonna show up to this, so looks like some people did, which is pretty cool. So let's get right into it. I was 15 when I saw this for the first time, and I am completely serious when I say that it changed the course of my life. From Lucky Star, also known by learned individuals as Best Girl. Anyway, so this is going to be about Moe. So I'm going to quickly ask the audience if anyone has any like a vague idea of what Moe might be. You were right for it.
Yeah.
Cutesy stuff. That's part of it. Sure. Way back.
I know originally it meant like a feeling that you get when you see something endearing.
Okay, that's pretty good too. So let's start with our the greatest source in the world, Wikipedia. Wikipedia defines Moe as feelings of strong affection, mainly towards characters, usually female, but we'll get to that in a minute, in anime, manga, video games, and other media directed at the otaku market. I define it a little bit more simply. I see it as an intense urge to want to protect and take care of something. This is how you write it in Japanese. It comes from the verb moeru, which means to sprout, but moeru, like this, it's not showing up here. Okay, so I guess that's not gonna work. Here we go. If you write moeru like this, it means to burn. Moeru written like this means to sprout. This is the meaning that everyone else uses. And this is how people spell when they're talking about moe as a concept. Anyway, although the term moe is relatively new, the basic idea of it has been around for quite a while. Helen McCarthy cites Osamu Tezuka's manga Lost World from 1948 as an early example of moe. There's one story in Lost World in which a scientist genetically engineers girls out of plants to use as slave labor, but a young scientist named Kenichi befriends a plant girl named Ayame, and they become stranded on a deserted planet together, and they decide to live together as brother and sister. A few decades later, a little series came out called Magical Princess Miki Momo, in his book, The Moe Manifesto, Dr. Patrick Galbraith got to sit down with Toshihiko Sato, who was one of the people responsible for Magical Princess Miki Momo. And Sato-san recalls some stuff that happened early in the history of the fandom. Okay, stop me if you've heard this one before. A toy company commissions an animation studio to make a series so they can sell toys to little girls. It comes out to a relatively little fanfare. Then 6 months later, they realize that it's crossed over, and now grown men are watching it because it's cute. Sound familiar? Anyone want to just shout it out?
MLP.
Yes, My Little Pony. Wait. So yes, grown men have been watching stuff for little girls for a while now. It is like I haven't personally seen Minky Momo, but it's probably pretty solid. All right, so let's kind of. So now I want to talk a little bit about where the term moe came from. One theory you'll hear people assert sometimes is that it came from Hotoru Tomoe from Sailor Moon. After all, she does check off some of the boxes people have come to associate with moe, and her last name is actually spelled with the kanji that I showed you a minute ago. But there are some problems with that. The first is that Hotoru was almost never referred to by her last name in the manga, or the anime for that matter. She was usually just called Hotoru-chan. The second thing is, it would be pretty weird for her, the second part of her last name, to be used as a nickname. So, it's probably not Hotoru. The editor of the Sailor Moon fan site, Tuxedo Unmasked, talked about this a little bit, and he proposed two alternate origins. The first is Moe Sagisawa from the anime Dinosaur Planet, and the other is Moe Takatsu from the manga Smash Into the Sun. Both of those are from 1994. Okay, so the website projectharuhi.net ran an article called The Four Laws of Moe, and it describes four characteristics that Moe characters are supposed to have. So let's go through them. So we met Tsukasa earlier in the video clip, but I'm also going to be mentioning two other characters I really like, Toru from Miss Kobayashi's Dragon Maid, and Squid Girl. Okay, first and foremost, these characters are cute. Like, really cute. Like, makes you want to squeal. Two things you'll see very often are characters that have really big eyes and mouths that are really small in proportion to their heads, especially when their mouths are closed. Incidentally, I made this whole thing here. I enjoyed every minute that it took. Haven't mentioned that she's my waifu, because she is. She also has a particular set of features that you see often, and I like to call the moe trifecta. She has big droopy eyes, hair that comes down to about just below chin level, and a smile that can thaw a frozen heart. You will see this everywhere if you go looking for it. If you've seen K-On!, which was made by the same studio as Lucky Star, Yui also has those three traits. The second thing is that these characters are often very young. It's very rare that you'll see a character that evokes moe and is older than, say, their late teens. But of course, that doesn't mean that it's impossible for older characters to be moe, because sometimes a character will just look and act younger than they really are. It's never specifically said how old Squid Girl is. I think she's implied to be somewhere between like 10 and 14. So she's probably on the low end. On the high end, Toru, who we saw a moment ago and we'll see again later, is implied to be hundreds, if not thousands of years old, but is still adorable. Because dragons. Third thing is that moe characters are innocent. They don't get into a lot of trouble, and if they are portrayed as villains, then it'll be for comedic effect. Squid Girl is a great example. She shows up to try to take over the world, and she ends up bungling it so badly that she has to wait tables at a restaurant. Tsukasa is another example of a character who's really innocent. There's one strip in the manga where her idea of an April Fool's joke is lying about the fact that she told a lie. We don't deserve her. The fourth thing, and we're not talking about My Hero Academia, but these characters are quirky. Why do I think that's funny? Quirks can take a few different forms. They can be visual things, they can be behavioral, they can even be verbal. So Toru here has a few moe quirks you probably noticed already. She's in a maid outfit, she has horns, she has a tail. When I was talking about verbal quirks earlier, Squid Girl has a really good verbal moe quirk in that she ends all of her sentences either with yeso in the Japanese or in the English dub she just makes a bunch of aquatic puns, and it works so well. So we talked a little bit about what moe is. Now I want to briefly talk about what moe is not. one of the biggest misconceptions people have is that moe is supposed to has something to do with sexual desire, or that it has something to do with the concept of lolicon, which means being attracted to little girls. It's really not that. So Dr. Galbraith, when he was talking to people in the industry about what moe means to them, they would use a few different terms, but none of them talked about it in terms of sexual desire. In fact, the word they probably used more than anything else was love. Now, love is a pretty abstract thing. If any of you speak Greek, you might know that the Greek language has four different words for love: storge, philia, eros, and agape. But none of those are really associated with lust or sexual desire. Even something like eros is more about the love between a husband and wife. There's nothing inherently sexual about that. Also, just as an aside, I was really tempted to use that panel from The Light of Tsukimi Manor, but, you know, even I have standards. I'm not completely evil. The second misconception is that moe has to be a female thing. It does not. Although just because of the target demographics, moe characters do tend to be female, but that doesn't necessarily that does not by any means indicate that boys cannot be moe too. When I was in high school, my friends and I were really into Italia, and Italy is extremely moe and extremely great. Ditto for Momiji Soma from Fruits Basket, which, by the way, I've heard, I just found out is getting a remake pretty soon. So that'll be interesting to see how that goes. Okay, so we talked about what moe is, and we talked about what moe isn't. So now I want to talk a little bit about what specifically attracts people to this. The big thing, at least for me, is the art style. So we talked previously about the big eyes and small mouths. The other thing you see is a particular way in which characters are drawn. It's very curvy. It doesn't. Characters are usually drawn without very many straight lines. So the screen cap here is a pretty good example of that. So I want you to pay attention specifically to Squid Girl's face, and even more specifically, her cheeks. So you'll notice that her cheeks are very rounded and almost kind of pudgy. And then as you move down to her chin, instead of coming to a sharp point like you see in some manga, it kind of flattens out at the bottom before curving back up. So there are very few straight lines in her design. And it makes her what Digibro described at one point as kind of like a marshmallow, where she looks like if you poked her or it would kind of squish. This style of high list sometimes called puny plush, because it makes everything look really soft and squishy. The use of color can also have a big impact on how these characters are perceived. I talked a little previously about how Squid Girl, when she first shows up, tries to take over the world, but she's clearly early way too innocent for that. The colors of her outfit and her hair / tentacles are kind of reflective of that. Blue and white are both associated with calmness, innocence, purity, things like that. Not really things you would associate with a brutal dictator. And in a lot of these series, it's not just the appearances of the characters, although that's certainly a big part of it. The other thing is that these shows will often have very bright, very calming colors, and the scenery will often have a lot of detail. We'll touch on that in a minute when I start talking about specific series. Another thing is that these series typically don't have a lot of story. Moe is often associated specifically with the slice of life genre, which is focused more on the day-to-day lives of the characters rather than ever any overarching plot. And as part of the research for this panel, I started a discussion thread on Reddit to ask fans of Moe what drew them to this. And one thing that repeatedly came up in that thread was people liked being able to get away from their real problems. it's kind of a break from the drama and the monotony of, you know, of the real world, and a chance to get out of that and into something where the most pressing thing you talk about that day is which side you eat a chocolate corn at. And I mean, and that's pretty much Lucky Star in a nutshell. It's, you know, it's mostly just cute girls sitting around and having random conversations about life. So now, I'm a big believer that there's absolutely nothing wrong with a bit of wish fulfillment every now and then. I mean, if the real world fulfilled all of our desires, then we would really have a reason to even to write fiction in the first place. But so I honestly don't think it's that big a deal that these characters are often portrayed in an unrealistic way. I mean, I'm not your mother. I'm not going to lecture you about how real women don't look like this. We know. That's why we watch it. And the other thing is that to a certain extent, I think the appeal for characters like this is that the viewer can fantasize about being these characters' significant others. That's why these characters are often innocent and don't have much experience with romance. One place where it can kind of cross the line, though, is when real people start getting involved in this. Idol singers are often associated with moe, and when that dynamic image is enforced, it can cause some problems. The idol group AKB48 is notorious for not allowing its members to date. And a few years ago, there was a minor scandal involving a member of AKB48 named Minami Minegishi. And basically what happened was she got caught walking out of her boyfriend's apartment, and she immediately dropped a trainee status, and she was so humiliated by the whole situation that she went and shaved her head. And it was this big thing. She was in tears, apologizing to her fans. It was all over the news. There were all these think pieces in the Western media about how idols are treated in Japanese society. That's pretty gross. And it's not something, that's definitely not something that I personally endorse. This is just supposed to be a fun, innocent fantasy. It's not supposed to control people's lives. And finally, this is another thing that I got to earlier, but a lot of times it can be exciting to feel like you're protecting something, especially something small and vulnerable and really, really cute. In the Reddit thread I had mentioned a couple slides ago, the top response in that thread was, and I quote, "For me, it's just the anime version of seeing a doggo. Nothing short of poetry." I mean, just perfection. Okay, and now for the part of the panel where I just gush about shows I like and think that you might like as well. Okay, this first one's gonna be a little bit out there. It's not really what most people associate with moe, but bear with me. Spice and Wolf. Someone knows what's up. Okay, so Spice and Wolf is definitely not what most people immediately think of when you ask them to think about moe. Yeah, okay, it is that. So it's not your typical moe series. It's not this over-the-top barrage of sweetness and light. It's actually a pretty compelling romantic drama about medieval economics that just so happens to have a super gorgeous wolf girl who falls around the male lead. It also avoids a problem you sometimes see in moe, where the characters were, or will be treated in a really infantilized and immature way. And while there is a certain appeal to that, Holo from Spice and Wolf avoids that by having a lot more agency in what happens to her. But at the same time, she's still very cute and very moe. And now for something completely different. Laid Back Camp.
Yes!
Yeah!
Woo! Oh. Laid Back Camp. It's also called Old Yudu Camp, or I like to call it Comfy Camp, because it is so very comfy. It's... I mean, if you just need something really cute and really hilly, inoffensive to get you through a rough spot in your life, allow me to make a case for laid-back camp. This is part of a particular style of anime and manga called yashike, or healing, and it's meant specifically to have a soothing effect on the viewer, and that can be incredibly impactful on someone. Laid-back camp just doesn't have any big plot twists. It doesn't have any pulse-pounding action scenes that are going to have you standing up and going, "Oh!" What it does have is a group of really cute girls who go camping and eat good food. That's pretty much all that happens. And underneath all that, there is some story, because at the same time, it's also about how the story of a loner realizing that it's not so bad to have friends. I think how I would interpret the characters of Laid Back Camp, and more specifically the main characters Rin and Nadeshko. I would say Rin is the audience insert, and then Nadeshko is the over the top moe blob love interest who doesn't actually get with Rin because life is cruel and unfair. But Rin is pretty light on moe, and then Nadeshko makes up for that tenfold. So again I mentioned before that these kinds of series are to a certain extent appeal to people who have trouble talking to people in the real world. So I can see why people would relate to Rin, and also maybe be really excited by the idea of being. A loner, a hunter who also, to a certain extent, gets rescued by the exact kind of person they need at that point in their life, because that's basically what happens between these two. And now for a little bit of a throwback, Azumanga Daioh. Yes. Culture. All right, so Azumanga Daioh. If I would describe the hype this really briefly, it's laugh out loud funny, and also a series that laid the groundwork for many other series to come. K-On!, Lucky Star, Nichijo, Pony Pony Dash, name a slice of life show, Hidamari Sketch. All of those series, while all great and have all contributed something to the genre, one of the progenitors of this style of a series that takes place in high school, stars a bunch of cute girls, and doesn't have much of an overarching plot, a lot of that started or was at least perfected by Azumanga Daioh. It proved that a series that is very light on plot and can survive based solely on the strength of a cast of well-developed, endearing characters and side-splitting writing. It's sometimes called Seinfeld, but in a Japanese high school, and I think that's pretty appropriate because it's a show about nothing. A couple of things I do want to point out is the English dub. While I'm partial to it, is not exactly a masterpiece because there are certain things in this anime that don't really translate well into English because. Just to give you an example, Yukari, one of the side characters, is an English teacher in the original Japanese, but because everyone's already speaking Japanese, she gets turned what in the script is called a language teacher, and all the parts where she's supposed to be speaking English, she usually ends up speaking Spanish instead. And the other thing I want to point out is, because if you are actually going to watch this, is that the last episode is a field trip and will make you cry. All right, and then we come to a series that I put in here at the last minute because I am trash and will watch anything adorable, Nyanko Days. Okay, so Nyanko Days. This is a series that came out about a year or two ago. Is that right? Anyway, it's basically pure sugar. It's about a schoolgirl who doesn't have many friends, but when she comes home, she has three tiny, very cute moe blob cat girls. who are her pets. There's a Munchkin cat named Ma, a Russian Blue named Imro, and a Singapore named Shi. It has a really short runtime. It's 12 episodes, but each episode is only about 2 minutes long. So you can actually binge watch the whole thing in the time it would take to watch one episode of pretty much any other series. So if you have a short attention span, you might want to check this out. And you know, I'll readily admit that the characters are one-dimensional, and the plot is enough to make even something like Azumanga Daioh look like Full Metal Alchemist. And yet I love this series. It is just so very cute and just so innocent. Just try not to think too much about the fact that these tiny cat girls have a human level, or at least close to human level intelligence, but are still being kept as pets by humans. Maybe not. So that's a bit to unpack, but it's just, but if you're willing to just turn your brain off on that part, it's pretty good. It's, you know what? Screw it. We still have like 30 minutes, so I have some time to pull something up. Okay, so I'm gonna go to Honey YouTube and show you the ending for Nyanko Days. Whoops. Okay. This is why you watch Nyanko Days. Okay, cool.
Thank you.
You're welcome. While I have YouTube up, I mentioned on the laid back camp slide that this series has a really catchy opening tune. So just to get it stuck in your head for the rest of the afternoon, let's check that out. I promise after this we'll get back to the slides, but I just have to show you this because it's perfect. Yeah, it does sound like Jackson 5. That's the weird thing. And they do not get together. They are not a couple. It's like I exist just to suffer. But yeah, if you were on the Wholesome Yuri subreddit while this series was airing, you saw a lot of those two. Not that I'm complaining. Okay, so let's get back to the slides. All right, we're going to talk. So now we're going to talk about a series that y'all may have heard of from a couple years ago called Kevin O'Friends. Okay, so Kevin O'Friends. This is a series about animals that have been turned into cute girls. What has science done? So the thing you have to understand about Kevin O'Friends is that it was produced on a shoestring budget by a team that didn't have a lot of experience, and it's all CG. So the animation's a little bit dodgy. It kind of looks like an N64 game sometimes, and yet it's actually really well written for something, and for considering the just for a cutesy moe show, but it has a lot of characters, and it's in all the and. What sets it apart is that it's not your typical nothing happens for 20 minutes and yet you watch it anyway because you just love cute things. It's in every episode has its own little plot as well as an overarching plot about the protagonist who is not pictured here, Eric Kaban, trying to figure out who she is and trying to hide to save this world that's seemingly been abandoned by the rest of society. It does have a second season that's airing right now, but it's from a different director, and there's some behind the scenes drama that I really don't feel like getting into. So I have not personally seen the second season of Kevin O'Friends, so I could not vouch for the quality of it. But I'm going to go out on a limb and say that it's probably fine. Feel free to come find me after the panel if you want to argue about that. Now, before we move on, I want to actually talk about a particular aspect of the Kevin O'Friends fandom that some of you may have heard of. Let's talk about Grape Coon.
Yeah.
All right, so in April 2017, the Tobu Zoo in the Saitama Prefecture of Japan placed cardboard cutouts of Kevin O'Friends characters in and around the exhibits. It was then that something amazing happened. A Humboldt penguin named Grape Coon, who had recently lost his mate, became obsessed with the cutout of the character Hululu, who is also a Humboldt penguin. This got a lot of international media attention, and a lot of people were describing Grape Coon as being in love with Hululu, almost like she was his waifu. I mean, that's basically what happened, right? He got rejected by his 3D mate and found a 2D one who was better. The sad part, however, is that eventually the zookeepers had to physically separate them for at least part of the day because otherwise he would not eat. And later that year, his health started taking a turn for the worse, and in October he passed away. There was an outpouring of grief from Kevin O'Friends fans, and then in January 2018, a new cutout was installed in the Humboldt Penguin exhibit that shows Grape Coon and Hululu standing side by side. I'm just gonna let that sit for a minute. So, moral of the story: even penguins know that 2D is all you need. Okay. So let's briefly talk about some manga that I like. These are series that don't have a full-fledged anime adaptation, but are still really great and are still worth your time. The first, some of you may have seen on my desk here, is Yotsubato. This is a series from Kyoriko Azuma, the creator of Azumanga Daioh. And it's just a really nice story about a little girl, her adoptive dad, and the friends they make along the way. One thing I want to draw attention to is if you're trying to learn Japanese, then this is actually a really good series to get into because all the kanji show the pronunciations, and it's made for kids, so you won't get a lot of intricate vocabulary that you'll have a hard time understanding. So I wouldn't recommend this for absolute beginners, but if you at least know hiragana and katakana, and excuse me, and you at least have a basic grasp of Japanese grammar, you should be able to get through without too much trouble. There are also reading guides that you can download online for the first two volumes to help you get through it. But anyway, this is just a really fun show. I mean, manga rather. And I got this from an Amazon seller that happens to have Japanese language books. And then I went to Amazon.co.jp and bought volumes 2 and 3 directly from there because they ship worldwide. I'm sorry?
The Japanese volumes are Kinokuniya, the one right here, carries the Japanese version of Yotsubo as well as the manga.
Is that near here?
There's one in Austin.
Okay, cool. No, I was not aware of that. I was just importing them and paying the outrageous fees. I mean, they're not outrageous, and Amazon Japan's pretty fair, but you have to wait for them to actually get all the way from Japan to your door, and that could be kind of a bummer. So the second one is Seiyaki Kitsune no Senko-san. This is a series that I just recently started getting into. It's about an 800-year-old fox spirit thing who starts taking care of a grizzled salaryman as his wife slash mother because reasons. It's kind of like Miss Kobayashi's Dragon Maid, except instead of sexual tension, you just get fluffy tails. I cannot even begin to tell you how much I want to touch the fluffy tails. The only catch is that it's not licensed for distribution outside of Japan. But if you literally just type Seiyaki Kitsune no Senko-san into Google, you'll find places where you can read it. I probably said too much. But anyway, the good news is this is actually getting an anime adaptation in April. It's going to be from the same studio that did the anime of Yuru Yuri, and I expect this to be appointment viewing for me. And finally, we come to a series called Kase-san. Now I don't normally read high school love stories, just for personal reasons. It's because, you know, I was single for pretty much all of high school and all of college, all of grad school. So your typical high school love story kind of rubs me the wrong way. It's why I haven't seen Toradora, I haven't seen Nisekoi, I haven't seen Your Name. Yeah, fight me. But I can make an exception for Kase-san because it is just so very cute. It's also Yuri. If you were upset about Rei to Nadeshiko not getting together in late back camp, Kase-san might be what you're looking for. It's just about two really sweet and really cute girls trying to figure out what it means to be a couple. I found out about this actually from Annie from Vitamin H. She mentioned this in her Yuri panel, and then I just knew that I had to get into it. So if you want to get into Kase-san, go talk to her. It also got on an OVA last year that aired at Anime Expo, but it doesn't really have an official distributor yet. However. The limited edition Blu-ray release does have English subtitles, and it's region free. It's just expensive, but you know, again, go talk to Andy from Vitamin H, that's all I'm gonna say. However, if it does get an official distributor, I will be first in line to pick up a copy. Okay, so I know I tend to be a giant ball all of energy and excitement and weird humor and inappropriate sex jokes at anime conventions, but I wasn't always like this, and in my personal life, I'm actually kind of a loner. I've been struggling with depression since adolescence, and I'll just be real with you. I have fantasized about killing myself far more often than I care to admit. It started when I was about 14 and never fully went away. I mean, I'm in therapy now, I'm medicated, but it's one of those things that never truly goes away. And I know this is gonna sound corny, but I truly believe that getting back into anime about 2 years ago is what saved my life. I would crawl into bed at the end of the day and pull up an episode of something like Squid Girl or Miss Kobayashi's Dragon Maid. I would pull that up on my phone, and even if it was just for a little while at a time, I didn't hurt as much. And that was exactly what I needed at that moment. And I'm not telling you this because I want you to feel sorry for me or make this big production about how, if you need to reach out, please talk to someone, which you should, but that's not the point. The point is that there's so much more to this than cute girls doing cute things, and I hope now that you understand that. So we still have a little. We still have about 15 minutes. So, any questions? Yes. The question was what's my opinion on how Moe affects the anime industry? I'm gonna say that it's actually a good thing. Because it's like I just described. It can be a source of comfort for a lot of people, and it's also something that doesn't just appeal in Japan but around the world as well. If you may notice that on some recent home video releases from studios that was like Funimation and Sentai Filmworks, you'll actually see the Crunchyroll logo on the DVD case, because Crunchyroll is primarily consumed by people outside of Japan, and yet the money they put in is allowing shows like Miss Kobayashi's Dragon Maid to get produced. So I think not only is it a giant cash cow, but it's actually doing a lot of good. Now I get that not everyone's into this. I understand if you wish we could go back to a time when everything was less over the top, maybe a little bit more gritty. I've actually been watching The Rose of Versailles lately, which is a series that premiered in 1979, and is actually a period drama about the French Revolution, and it's very far removed from everything I've shown this panel so far, and yet it's still really good. I don't think the style of the Rose of Versailles versus the art style of something like Lucky Star, I don't necessarily see any of them as being better or worse than the other. To me, they're just different. And if one or the other is what you're into, that's fine. And I think both have room to coexist. So does that answer your question? Okay, great. Any other questions? I'll be in the back.
So, do you think that slice of life anime and moe anime
from certain male characters has the same potential as one of the female characters?
Because there's stuff like Sanrio Nachi and stuff that wasn't as well received as like most female moe anime.
The question was, do I think that moe boys have the same potential as moe girls? I'm gonna say no, and I'm going to explain why. Not because of any sort of bigotry, just a simple matter of the fact that a lot of this stuff is consumed by men, and most men are attracted to women, and so I think the people who are going to be consuming this sort of thing are more likely to be into it if it has cute girls than cute boys. However, I realize that women do get a kick out of this as well. And in fact, I actually mentioned Italy from Italia Alia. This is a series that I think originally ran. Is considered a seinen series, meaning it's aimed at young men, but it has a huge female crossover appeal. And I mean, it's full of cute boys. And yes?
I just want to point out the popularity of Moron and how people are very, very cute, especially like Honey.
Yeah, the, That's actually a really good point. The boys in Oran High School Host Club are pretty, but I wouldn't necessarily hear. And although Honey Senpai being the exception, they're not typically drawn in a style that we associate with moe. So. Earlier, I talked about how a character like Squid Girl or Tsukasa will be drawn in a way, in a very curvy style with very few straight lines. As I recall, the boys in Oran were drawn in a certain style more associated with shoujo manga. So it's not not necessarily the case the guys drawn in the traditional shoujo way can't be moe. It's just that it's not what most people immediately think of. Does that answer your question? Okay. Anyone else? We still got plenty of time. Okay. So we still got plenty of time. So is the person who's coming on after me already here?
Kind of. It's just
going to
set up and play a video type thing. So
okay.
Probably 8 to 10 minutes until we need to.
Okay. So I played the opening for Laid Back Hamburger earlier. Since we still have plenty of time, I'm actually going to show the ending for Laid Back Camp as well, because I think it's a really good reflection of what I mentioned earlier about how moe can have a really soothing effect. So please enjoy Fuyu Biori. Oh dear. I think that's a good place to wrap it up. You've been a wonderful audience. Thank you very much.